Just after midnight, in the early morning hours of March 24th, 1989, a giant oil tanker, a 200,000-ton oil tanker, found itself in just about the worst kind of trouble that an oil tanker can possibly find itself. It had just set sail from its home port. It was on its way to its destination, and then, boom, this giant tanker hit a reef in the open water and started spewing crude oil uncontrollably all over the place. The tanker had only made it about 25 miles from where it left from, a tiny port city called Valdez, Alaska. The Exxon Valdez oil spill was, at the time, the worst oil spill in U.S. history. In all, about 11 million gallons of crude oil released into Prince William Sound. When it came to cleaning up all that oil, something very telling happened. The president at the time, George H.W. Bush, Poppy Bush, sent the commandant of the Coast Guard up to Alaska to run the cleanup effort. And in the course of running that cleanup effort, the commandant of the Coast Guard told Exxon that he was going to need 5,000 workers to help clean up the beaches up there. Exxon said, 5,000 workers? No way. Exxon told the highest ranking member of the United States Coast Guard, no. Now, the commandant of the Coast Guard, knowing that he had been sent up there by the White House, told Exxon that maybe they would have to take it up with the White House. Exxon said, well, that's no problem. And a short time later, after receiving a call from Exxon, the White House informed the commandant of the Coast Guard that actually, yeah, he was not getting those 5,000 cleanup workers that he had requested. Fast forward to 2001. The state-owned oil company of India wants in on a giant oil drilling project happening off the coast of Russia. India's state-owned oil company gets a sign-off from Russia, but there's a little problem. The company that's operating the project is ExxonMobil, and ExxonMobil is not so sure about the Indians getting in on this thing. In a meeting at the White House that year, India's prime minister tries to lobby then-President George W. Bush, Bush the Jr., to push Exxon along on this issue, saying, why don't you just tell them what to do? President Bush's response, quote, nobody tells those guys what to do. For ExxonMobil, one of the largest corporations in the whole world, pleasing a U.S. president, whether it's George W. Bush or George H.W. Bush or any other president, just has never really been necessary. Exxon, after all, is going to be around a lot longer than any U.S. president, than any Indian prime minister, than any lowly U.S. Coast Guard commandant. As the author and journalist Steve Call puts it in his new book about ExxonMobil, which is called Private Empire, quote, the time horizons for Exxon's investments stretched out longer than those of almost any government it lobbied. Quote, we see governments come and go, Exxon CEO Lee Raymond once remarked. Exxon could afford to carry themselves with this type of bravado because, as Steve Call writes, quote, in effect, Exxon was America's energy policy. Certainly there was no governmental policy of comparable coherence. Exxon has been able to maintain that sort of staying power, not just because of its multiple presidential administrations' long time horizons on its money-making plans, but also because of its single-mindedness, on its single-minded focus. I mean, the oil industry is the most profitable venture that humankind has ever known. ExxonMobil can essentially think of itself as its own country. In practical terms, it is its own country. Exxon's annual revenues are larger than the annual GDP of all these countries that you see zooming up the screen right now. Exxon has a bigger economic footprint than about 150 countries. So if you're a giant oil company like Exxon, what exactly do you spend all that money on? Well, obviously you spend it on making yourself even more money. This week in Houston, Texas, the oil industry got together to show off its latest breakthrough technological achievements. Most of these achievements, of course, have to do with allowing oil companies to drill for oil further and faster and in riskier environments than has ever been done before. Earlier this week, engineers announced plans to drill the deepest undersea well ever drilled, ever. On Earth, 12,000 feet deep. They say it will make it possible for companies to drill into the mantle of the Earth. The big draw today in Houston was this contraption. Look, appropriately named the Claw. The Claw is an incredible technological feat that allows oil companies to recover oil platforms that have sunk. Platforms that have sunk to the bottom of the ocean after some horrible drilling accident. You send the claw down, you scoop up your damaged oil platform, and then, of course, you can see what you can salvage so you can move on to the next project. A little oil in the water, well, that's the cost of doing business. All of the big technological advancements in the incredibly wealthy oil industry right now. The thing that the oil industry appears to be spending all of its money on right now, to the extent they're spending it on anything other than themselves and joy, all of the things they are investing in are ways to drill further. Not necessarily ways to drill safer, and certainly not ways to clean that sort of thing up when it goes wrong. While the profits for that sort of drilling end up being private, while the profits may allow a single company to be, say, wealthier than 150 separate countries, the cost of pursuing those profits, well, that very often ends up being public. We are the ones who pay for that. You know, us and the otters. We pay for that, even if our own president appears to be taking orders sometimes, not from us, but from the only person more powerful than an American president, an oil company CEO. Joining us next for the interview is Pulitzer Prize-winning author Steve Call, who just wrote the book, really the only book ever, on Exxon and the amazing ways in which they wield their private empire of power. Stay with us. Broad strokes, big picture. If you had to say what the 1990s were about, economically and in terms of the grand big picture changes in American priorities and outlook, what we were focused on, what changed us as a country, what was new and important about that decade, for the 90s, you might say technology, right? The internet. The 80s ended with the end of the Cold War, the end of the bipolar superpower universe, and that sort of division of labor and division of power and priorities in the country and in the universe, right? The 90s ended up after that being about tech. Then after the 90s, the 2000s ended up being about non-nation state powers, about terrorism, about war. The 2010s, where we are now, sort of still to be determined, right? But if I had to bet on something here, if I had to bet on one big idea that's ultimately, in retrospect, going to define this decade, I'd bet on energy. Joining us now for the interview is Steve Call, Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist, author of the new book, Private Empire, ExxonMobil and American Power, which I think, in my opinion, I think is sort of the defining book, at least so far, about power and energy and the future. Steve, congratulations on this.
Thank you.
You date a lot of the important changes, not just in energy, but in power and in the division between companies and countries, to 1989, to the collapse of the Soviet Union. That's sort of an important frame of reference for you in talking about why ExxonMobil is so important in the world. Did the rise of corporate power of the kind that you document here become possible because of the collapse of the superpowers?
Yes, it did. Globalization meant that corporations like ExxonMobil could work in so many more places than before. And so their sense of themselves changed. You know, during the Cold War, they were part of a national system that was fighting an existential contest against another system. And so companies were much more rooted in their own states, in their home countries. And then after the Cold War, one of the things that happened was that these corporations, especially oil corporations, became dispersed all over the world. And they became more sovereign unto themselves and less tethered to their home countries. And Lee Raymond, who you quote saying, "We see governments come and go," he also said at one point, "I'm not a U.S. company. I have to think about my shareholders and my breadth across 180 different countries." So I do think that was an important moment. The other thing that happened, and your terrific piece points this out, was that they got driven more and more into risky frontiers, geopolitical frontiers and technological frontiers. During the 60s and 70s, during the Cold War, they were able to own all kinds of oil and gas in big pools of it in the Middle East. They had a chunk of Saudi Arabia, they had a chunk of Iraq, they had a chunk of Iran. And after nationalism rose in the Middle East and all these corporations got thrown out, they were driven basically to two places, to weak states that were too weak to do it themselves, so Chad, Equatorial Guinea, Angola, Nigeria, or to new technological frontiers where the risks were so great that only the very richest corporations could afford to develop the technologies to drill in deep water or under the ice or those kinds of places.
In terms of that last point about technological advancement and risk, did you feel like I mean, one of the things that's very interesting is defining, like, the presidents of the companies, people who are running the companies, and the way their personality and their overall approach to these things defines the way a huge company like this operates. Lee Raymond himself becomes such a fascinating character in this. But do you feel like institutionally, when you're dealing with oil companies with this much money and this much power and the kinds of time horizons that they've got, there is any way that, you know, small factors like the United States government, say, little players compared to them, can get them to take risk more seriously, to invest more in disaster preparedness and in making things safer as their economic imperative pushes them to drill deeper and faster and riskier all the time?
Well, you know, the record isn't very encouraging about that. And it was really exposed in the Deepwater Horizon disaster, where obviously it was a BP platform that blew up, but all of the oil companies, including ExxonMobil, have been required by the Department of Energy to file detailed plans about how they were prepared to meet a disaster of that type. This is, you know, two plus decades after the Valdez, when you'd think these lessons would have been inculcated. They, all the corporations, filed the exact same plan. They had the same consultant. They talked about remediating mammals that had never lived in the Gulf for eons. They, in ExxonMobil's case, they had a 48-page annex about how to deal with the media, more paper about media relations than about actual disaster response.
One of their cited experts had been dead for quite some
time. Yes. And the chairman testifying before Congress, when he had that pointed out, said, yes, but his work lives on.
So we would call him. He's a Ouija board to call him. You know, on that point, though, of the media appendix, I did not know before I read about it in your book about, I knew that all the companies had this boilerplate disaster response plan, including the walruses and the Gulf and all of this stuff. I did not know that Exxon's special sauce that they had added to the boilerplate was a 40-page long media annex. And I think you point out that it's a multiple of times longer, this annex, than it is their plan for dealing with cleaning up the oil. But why does a company as big and as powerful and as dominant as Exxon care about the media? Can't they afford not to?
They don't. You know, they generally have a media relations policy of saying no comment in about 50 different languages, and they I do think that they feel that they can succeed from a strategic posture of a defensive crouch and a basically a high wall. They have a straightforward policy of really not cooperating with the media in the way that many other corporations do. And, you know, to go back to this sort of idea about risk and regulation, whether the U.S. government can hold a corporation of that scale accountable, it's sort of a paradox, because on the one hand, you know, a company like ExxonMobil is very conservative about the way it operates in the Gulf, because the Deepwater Horizon proves you're betting the company every day you're out there. And if you blow up, you're going to pay a very high price. So there's a bias towards, well, let's be very careful. But as your piece pointed out, the actual business drives them more and more into risk.
Yeah.
So there's this constant tension every day. And to some extent, the regulators are incidental to that struggle. It really happens inside the corporation separately. Now, the National Commission that investigated the Gulf spill in 2010, a bipartisan, very kind of blue ribbon sort of commission, they concluded very emphatically that the industry has been underestimating the risks that it takes every day in these kinds of waters. And they said the government also was so captured by industry that its regulations were patently, you know, inadequate.
You describe it as a slovenly embrace, I think, between the regulators and the regulated in this case. Steve Call, this is this is an encyclopedic work about a very, very big and important company, but it's also the kind of reporting about the institutions that shape the decisions that we think we are allowed to make that I think ends up being a total game changer in terms of the way we think about power in our country and in the world. This is great. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much,
Rachel.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Steve Call is a Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist. The new book is called Private Empire, ExxonMobil and American Power. It's a really big deal. All right.